Hey guys, happy Saturday. Hope everybody's doing good today. It's been a pretty low-key day here, and just kind of relaxed and went for a walk earlier this afternoon. So I kind of have been delaying recording a video for today because I'm pretty sure I'm not going to be able to get through reading this without crying. So I'm just going to jump in and hopefully I won't completely embarrass myself. But if that happens, I'm sorry. So this is my blog on Psalm 11, and it is entitled Running from Myself. And the synopsis is, who knows how different my life would be if I'd ended up with what I was running to, but God. Psalm 11 is only 7 verses, so pretty short. And it says, in the Lord I take refuge. How then can you say to me, flee like a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bows. They set their arrows against the strings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. He observes everyone on earth. His eyes examine them. The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked, those who love violence, he hates with a passion. On the wicked, he will rain fiery coals and burning sulfur. A scorching wind will be their lot, for the Lord is righteous. He loves justice. The upright will see his face. From the Enduring Word commentary for this psalm is this quote. This psalm records well-intentioned but faithless advice of David's friends when he was a fugitive from King Saul. David lifted his eyes to the Lord to find faith in a time of testing. He knew the safest place to stand was in radical trust in God. And that's a quote from the Enduring Word commentary on Psalm 11. The commentary for this psalm breaks down this psalm, examining how David responds to the advice from his friends to flee from Saul. The whole time I was reading, researching, taking notes, I kept thinking of a line from a song called I Could Run Away that I used to listen to in college. The line that kept running through my mind was, I could run away, but you would never leave. This song was woven into the very fiber of my being because of my own experience with running away as a teenager. Obviously, I wasn't a fugitive, but it's been about 20 years ago now, and I haven't forgotten what drove me to run. Real or imagined, there were feelings of being unwanted, misunderstood, confused, and unloved. I knew I was loved, but I didn't feel loved just for me. I didn't feel accepted as I am. Always too much and not enough all at the same time. So I ran. I ran with no concern or consideration for the ones I was running from. I ran to a total stranger who I thought would give me what I longed for. I was 16 years old. Who knows what I would have discovered if I'd actually ended up at my destination, but God. I didn't know until later that from the moment my grandma found out I was gone, she was praying, Lord, don't take her from us, but do what you need to for her to be stopped. Don't let her get where she's headed. And stop me is exactly what he did. I'd taken my mom's car along with her ATM card and had been driving over 12 hours when I fell asleep as I was taking a hairpin turn. I was driving at such a high rate of speed, the car was flung off of the road and rolled 6 times. I'm pretty sure I should be dead, but God. And in my blog, I shared pictures that I had taken after the accident of, we had gone back to get my things out of the car from wherever it had been towed to. So I'm just gonna, I think I can, oh, no, I can't. Okay, well, I thought I could turn this around and show you these pictures, but maybe I'll just do it the clunky way. I don't know if you can see that or not. This is like real high tech here. you can tell I'm not a natural at this. Okay, and there's a glare. Oh, there you go. Okay. So yeah, that is pictures that I included in the blog. Hopefully they showed up. I don't know. I'm not really good at this. Anyway, I woke up in the hospital, bruised on my forehead, across my chest and thighs from the seatbelt, which I hadn't been wearing for the majority of my 12 hours of driving, but I'd stopped right before I'd fallen asleep and had the thought as I was getting back on the highway that I should put my seatbelt on. I had cuts across my hands, not bad enough to need stitches, but still deep enough to leave scars, and I had a deep gash about 1.5 inches long on my left leg, which did require stitches, but that's it. I should have been grateful to be alive, but I remember feeling pissed off that my parents had to come get me. I don't remember the exact location I'd made it to when I crashed. I'm sure my parents would. But since I'd been driving over 12 hours, I knew I had that amount of time alone in the car with my parents to look forward to on the way home. The years may have blurred my memory, but I don't remember there being much conversation on the car ride home. 20 years later, and raising 2 strong-willed girls of my own has given me a much better appreciation for the living hell I put them through. At the time, though, I was a 16-year-old with a chip on my shoulder and hurt in my heart. After I returned home, I went to see my grandma. She was upstairs in her bedroom. I climbed the steps to her room, and as I rounded the corner, she said, "So you're alive." Very matter-of-fact, which was her way. She didn't even sound glad to see me, and I'm sure she wanted me to know how upset she was. But again, being 16 with that chip, I wasn't admitting defeat. So I responded with, "Yep, guess I'm lucky like that." This is the part that gets me. Tears formed in her eyes, and in her soft, loving way, she said, "That wasn't luck, that was God." Then she told me about how she was praying that God would stop me, and that she kept on praying until she got the call that I'd been taken to the hospital. I was completely floored, half mad because clearly it was her fault I didn't make it where I was headed, and the other half was so relieved to know she loved me enough to pray for me like that. Now, looking back, I question my inability to see just how loved I was, but hindsight's 20/20. I heard a song on the radio the other day called "Defender" by Francesca Battistelli. I'd heard it for the first time, and it moved me so powerfully. Of course, like always, I recommend that you listen to the song for yourself, but these lyrics at the end of the song spoke so loudly to me, I have to share them here. And these are the lyrics to the end of this, to the words at the end of that song. Whew. When I thought I lost me, you knew where I left me. You reintroduced me to your love. You picked up all my pieces, put me back together. You were the defender of my heart. And all I did was praise. All I did was worship. All I did was bow down. All I did was stay still. Hallelujah, you have saved me. So much better your way. Hallelujah, great defender. So much better your way. I feel like I started losing me all those years ago, but God knew where I left me. This past year, my recovery journey, my search to find me, has definitely reintroduced me to His love. He is picking up all the pieces I've dropped along the way and is putting me back together. He's started me back from the beginning, walking me back through my life to look at the situations that have shaped me, to look at what I believed about me, about my family, about Him. We're illuminating the lies and capturing the truth. He is undoubtedly the defender of my heart. He has saved me from myself more times than I can count. Sorry. He has brought me back home. He has brought me back home every time I've run from Him. He has wrapped His loving arms around me even when I felt so unlovable. He has never stopped looking on me with eyes of love. And all I can do is praise. All I can do is worship. All I can do is bow down. All I can do is stay still and stop running. I definitely agreed with David as I was reading this psalm. I'm still learning that running is never the answer. It doesn't make the hard stuff go away. It's still there when you get back. But then all that running makes you too tired to deal with any of it. So much better His way. Whew, okay. Well, I definitely didn't cry as much as I thought I would, but it's still... is emotional to think about how far God has brought me. I used to look back on my teenage years, which were filled with a lot of angst and a lot of regret and a lot of a lot of things I wish I could have done differently. But I did what I did, and it's part of my story. So part of my recovery is just learning to accept the good and the bad of every choice I've ever made, and hopefully learning from those situations or those mistakes, or allowing God to use that to help me shine His light in someone else's life, or just to be a person that understands what it's like to go through those kind of things. Whew. So, that is my blog on Psalm 11, and, I for sure am grateful today for how far God has brought me. I mean, beyond the teenage years, but, you know, every place in my journey that has been a time of running. I've spent a lot of years trying to do things my own way and go my own way and do my own thing, and then asking God to bless it, or wondering why I'm unhappy, or wondering why I'm so anxious when I'm choosing not to align myself with God. So anyway, this video has gotten a little bit longer than I expected, but I would just encourage, the thing that I would want to say to anybody that is maybe struggling with a couple different things. Number one, no matter what your past looks like, and I know, you know, people have a lot worse things than what I have in my past, but I do know that no matter what your past looks like, none of it is unforgivable. And the enemy wants us to hide under the blanket of shame, because he knows if we stay under the blanket of shame, it's going to blind us from the truth that can set us free. And so I would encourage anyone who's in that situation, just like I have been for most of my life, is to just take the blanket off. And it's as easy, I mean, I say it's easy, it's simple, just to say I'm not gonna believe that about myself anymore. And that's a everyday process, I feel like, with a lot of things. And there's layers, you know, God will take us to different layers of healing on the same thing, I feel like. You know, whatever we can handle at that time. And then I would also say that if you are running from God, or running from a situation, or running from something painful, sometimes, you know, we do have to separate ourselves from a situation that is toxic or abusive or manipulative or, you know, what have you. And those things are important. I'm not saying that. But in certain circumstances, you know, like I said at the end of the blog, running only makes us tired. And by the time we stop running, we're so tired from running that we don't even have the capacity to deal with whatever God's asking us to deal with. And so I have found, and I am still learning this, I'm a slow learner on stuff like this. When I'm faced with something uncomfortable or painful in my recovery, I'm learning to do my best to deal with it. And the way that I deal with it is to immediately, well, my best intention is to immediately say, God, this hurts. I don't understand this. I don't like this. I don't like the way it feels. I'm confused. I'm scared. I'm anxious. I'm angry. And to just get in touch with those things instead of shoving them down or turning to some other source of comfort. For me, that's always been food. But instead of turning to some other source of comfort, to go to the one that is gonna give us the true comfort that we need, and the clarity to find understanding, and the strength to deal with hard situations, and the patience to endure whatever it is that we're having to endure. And my whole life has been, I don't wanna deal with anything hard, so I'm going to isolate, I'm going to eat, and I'm gonna try and numb it all. And I, in doing that, I don't ever get to the other side of anything. So I had spent my whole life depressed and anxious and stuck and asking God to, you know, move me beyond, but I wasn't willing to let go of any of that to be moved. So that has been my experience. One of the things that I've learned in recovery is to get to the other side of anything, I have to be willing to surrender. I have to be willing to accept, to acknowledge and accept whatever it is that God is showing me, and then letting him do what he needs to do in the situation, and not pretending like I have all the answers or I can do anything to force an outcome to be, you know, whatever I want the outcome to be. So, anyway, those are just my pearls of wisdom for the night. So I hope that's been encouraging or helpful to anyone. If you're struggling, reach out. I'm willing to listen, to pray, to help in whatever way I can. You don't have to go through whatever you're facing by yourself. There's people that are willing and ready to support you or love on you or whatever it is that you need. So I hope everyone has a good rest of their Saturday, and I will be back tomorrow with Psalm 12 and hopefully a shorter video. All right, have a good rest of your evening. Bye-bye.